Hi, I'm Chase Sharkey with Sharkey Mechanical. Our team of experts handles some of the largest and most complex air conditioning systems in the state. Give us a call today and let us attack your air conditioning needs. 225-222-3332.
Update on the COVID-19 and the district's future plans. Superintendent, Ms. Stilley, you want to take over?
Yes, Mr. President. And I would ask everyone if you could mute your phones right now, just so it would help with the background feed, I think, the noise. So if you could just mute your computer or your phones if you're on those until we get through these next couple items, it'll help with the sound. First of all, good evening to everyone. It's great seeing you all and seeing you are okay this afternoon. We do have some updates. I'd like to start by talking a little bit about that we, you know, most of you know, all know that we have partnered with the Baylor Meals to You program to deliver meals to the homes of all of the students and their families that enrolled for these meals to be delivered in their home. UPS is the delivery mode that's being used to deliver the meals. They are working to deliver meals by this Thursday. That's round one, which is the first 2 weeks. And then they will have on Thursday another 15,000 boxes or so of meals being delivered to their site, their hub in Hammond. On Thursday, this is round two, and that's the next 2 weeks of meals. So our district does not influence the delivery of the meals. This is a responsibility that rests on UPS. I have been in contact with the supervisor there, and I know that they are working extremely hard to ensure that these meals get delivered as quickly as possible. But we all have to understand that across our parish, that it's almost worse than Christmas delivery time for them with the mass volume of meals that they're delivering. The meals will continue through May 22nd, which is the last day of school on our board approved calendar. We are seeking to find out if we can continue the meal deliveries over the summer, but at this time we are not approved for that, and we have no indication on whether or not they will continue it past May 22nd, but we will keep the board and the public informed as soon as we hear anything that will go past May 22nd. Also, we have pushed out through our Facebook page and our website. We also have a direct newsletter, electronic newsletter, that goes and is emailed to every family and community member that signed up. The local media, all of the instructional resources for continued learning for students. We also started releasing each week schedules that a family could follow to ensure that they cover the instructional material for that week. Included in these schedules are web-based resources from the Louisiana Public Broadcasting Channel, educational resources that are scheduled for students that do not have either computer devices at home or internet access, so they can actually access and watch these educational materials from their that channel, the PBS channel, on their television. We encourage our parents to continue to check our district's web page and our Facebook page for updates on resources and information. We're really pushing out data almost and information almost on a daily basis, and sometimes even twice a day regarding updates for families. So it's critical that our families check our Facebook page, the Tangipahoa Parish School Systems page, and our district website. Since the closing of our schools, our teachers have worked to stay connected to students and their families by utilizing email, phone calls, and Zoom virtual classroom meetings. Yesterday, on Monday the 20th, we sent out additional guidance for teachers on how they can stay connected virtually to the students and how they can provide feedback on instructional resources for our students. We ask for our parents out there that if you have not heard from your school or your child's teacher, that means that they do not have correct contact information from you. So we would ask you to either call the school and leave a message, email the principal, or email one of the teachers to make sure that they have the updated contact information for you on file at the school in terms of how to get in touch with you or the student. We have asked our teachers to collect information and share with us via a Google survey. And the information that we particularly want to know are the devices and the types of devices and the internet access for homeroom students in their classes. And we will utilize this information to make informed decisions about moving forward. A little bit about our seniors. Seniors received an email prior to the spring break asking them to follow up with their teachers if they were missing any work prior to the school closing in mid-May. After senior guidance was received from the Department of Ed, senior teachers were instructed to work with the seniors who were failing a class prior to the break. Senior grades will be finalized this week, and seniors will have their report cards mailed home to their homes. Again, if there's an address change or we do not have the correct addresses, then that will have an impact on them receiving their report cards. So you can change your address online now. If you go to our website, you can actually make a change of address or mailing address change from our Tangi School's website. We are also developing a senior information page for our website, frequently asked questions about student financial aid and NCAA requirements as they move and transition from high school to college. We are working now on a senior celebration that will launch on the day and time of their ceremonies, that their ceremonies would have been held in May. We continue to hope that the opportunity to hold the real traditional ceremonies and later in the summer, but we wanted to celebrate with our seniors in May when they would have had their regular graduation. More information will be released about this as we move closer to our graduations in May, which I think the first graduation is LaRonja High School, and there'll be virtual watch parties and things like that that parents, that students, their families, and friends can participate in the month of May. The next thing I wanted to talk a little bit about is our virtual courses. I think the last time we had our board meeting, I talked a little bit about making lemonade out of lemons. And one of the things that we wanted to see happen during and really capitalize on this event that we're having is for us to develop out true virtual classes and courses. So our teachers and content leaders across the parish are working to build an online virtual course platform for grades 3 through 12. These courses will be high quality, tier 1, engaging with live teacher instruction and interventions with students virtually. We will utilize the virtual classes this summer for eligible students who qualify for summer school, and in August, we will offer families full virtual or a blended model of instruction taught by highly qualified teachers at no cost to the parents. This option will be available for students in grades 3 through 12 who are registered in our school system. All teachers are continuing to add content to their Google and online on-course pages. This will assist us in closing the gaps that will occur from the closing, because of the closing of our schools. Also, it will assist us in the future by them having their Google and online classrooms. Whenever there are students that are absent because of illness, they can quickly get caught up on any missed work from the classroom through the Google Classroom or on-course pages for the teacher. But absolutely, the biggest challenge that we face today in our school system in terms of educating our children is the accessibility of the internet for our students. We are working now to collect accurate information about internet devices and devices, period, that students have access to at their home. At this time, we are working to secure enough Chromebooks for grades 3 through 12 for the students in our district, and we're working with state agencies to secure hotspots for students without internet capability in their home. Just like public libraries, we are also boosting the Wi-Fi in our schools, especially on the northern end of the parish, so that families can access the Wi-Fi from the parking areas around the school. For students who have the infrastructure to secure internet, which means they have the fiber optic cables, you know, running near their home, and they can actually access the internet, we are sharing with families the opportunities to secure this internet at a free or low cost to the family during this time. We are continually pushing that out on our website and on our Facebook page as well. To date, at our principal Zoom meeting, we've asked our principals to help us get this information to the families in their area. On another note, online registration is, our registration center is now closed, but families can actually register new students in our parish from their computer or their iPhone, their smartphone. They can register them and upload documents without having to enter the building for new students. They can also do address changes. I had several reach out on Facebook that they had moved during this time and they needed to change their addresses. They can do that also online from our website, just as a reminder about that. Our board policy is now online on our website, and we will continually update it as soon as the board approves the new policy. It will almost immediately be uploaded. If you remember, in our prior system, it took several months after the board approved a policy for it to actually be uploaded onto our website. So we're happy to say that we're now at the place where we have updated this, and our policy can be easily accessed not only for us, but for our employees and our parents and families out there who want to know what are the specific policies around particular things, and it will be almost real-time uploaded and as we approve it and make modifications. I also want to remind the public and encourage the public to complete their 2020 census. This information assists the district in securing funding, and it impacts so many areas that we don't even realize that it impacts for our children and in education. So we have posted information on our webpage, and we pushed it out through our Facebook page of the benefits of each person in Tangipahoa Parish completing their 2020 census. And I just want to encourage our families right now to do that. That's a way that you can help support our schools through many ways, one of which is to help with funding, just by doing the census. So we encourage you to do that. Finally, I want to just thank our employees and our students and our families out there for your patience during this time. We are definitely charting new waters during this unprecedented time. And we encourage everyone to, as things change daily, we want to encourage you to continue to monitor our Facebook page at Tangi School, is Tangipahoa Parish School System's Facebook page, and our website, because we are continually updating those pages for the public. So those are really the go-to places to find out additional information. In reflection, I think we feel great about the educational resources that we have provided for our families and particularly students. They are excellent. I don't know if you have been able to take a look at those on our website. They are very user-friendly. They are high quality and they are aligned to the curriculum. They are excellent. We know that we're building out an online platform that will be ready for the summer and for August for our students to have the option of either full virtual or blended virtual that's free. We're very proud of that. I can tell you that it's top notch. I would put it up against any online curriculum out there. And it's also provides time with our teachers through Zoom conferencing or face-to-face. So it's a great opportunity for us. Also, we're taking advantage of the additional CARES funding from the federal level to help secure the Chromebooks that we need for our students, which was one of the lemonades that we wanted to make out of lemons, and also to ensure that we can work. We will not stop until we can have as many children in our parish as possible have internet access, a Chromebook, and be connected to continuous learning. It's very important to us. And so I just want the board to know that. I know that there are certain areas in our parish that are kind of dead zones in terms of service, but we're every day having this conversation among our leadership team as well as with the state Department of Education on how we can do that. I have been in contact with Mr. Robbie Miller, and we'll be reaching out to Senator Mizell. I know this has been a big push for her as well, is broadband in all of our rural areas. And so we will continue to work until we have accomplished this goal in ensuring this. So that's all I have for our update on our COVID-19. Thank you.
Okay, Ms. Stilley, thank you very much. Item B, consider approval of recommendations for an outside charter school evaluator. I'm sorry, go ahead. You had a question, Mr. Duncan?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask some follow-up questions about what Ms. Stilley presented, if that's okay.
Go ahead.
Ms. Stilley, could you go a little bit deeper on the plans to kind of fill the gap, so to speak, of all of the instruction that's been missed the last couple of months? I know you sent out a press release on you know, kind of what y'all's current thinking is on how that's going to get dealt with, but can you talk a little bit more about that and specifically maybe address why we are not considering extending the calendar or the school day to try to fill that gap?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Duncan. That's great question, and I did not cover that in my talking points. First of all, we will offer a virtual summer for those students who are eligible. We will likely have to do that full virtual along with a teacher, highly qualified teacher. But one of the things that we're going to do quickly when school starts is we have a diagnostic assessment that is done on the computer. And it can quickly assess those standards and the skills from the previous year. It will help identify for the teachers what are the missing pieces for those students that they have missed either during this time period or that they haven't mastered in that previous year. And then we will modify our schedules to provide what we call gap time. Which is additional time for ELA and math, so that we can fill those gaps within the first 6 weeks of school and get those students back on track. That is the only way at this point that we know that we can get all students up to par quickly by assessing where they are, identifying the gaps, and then providing that gap time, additional instructional time within the day, by double blocking ELA and math. For those students who are proficient, when we do their diagnostic tests and they are proficient in those standards and skills, then those students will not be held back waiting for anything, but they will be provided with materials and resources and lessons and so forth that are both rigorous and relevant to their standards and their skills for that grade level. So that's our plan on making sure that we're filling that gap along with right now just offering those optional resources for students to stay connected to during this time.
So, and Ms. Stilley, can you address why we don't feel like we need to have some days or hours to make that up? I mean, it seems like this gap is going to be pretty substantial, and I guess maybe as a follow-up question there, if when we do this diagnostic, we find that the gap is more substantial than we thought, is this plan something that can be fluid and we can adjust later if we need to?
Yes, and we can also do some after school if we see the need to do that. We can provide some after school, extending the school day for students that are identified to have larger gaps than expected. So that's definitely fluid, and we're able to do that. I mean, the other thing about starting the school year earlier is at this point, you know, we're not sure about, you know, the reopening up of, you know, the America plan of the phases. You know, we're hoping to be at phase three by August. And so, but we feel confident that we can identify it, because once you do that assessment and you know what the gaps are, and then we know what to do with those gaps, and we'll have the time to do it. But we are fluid in terms of being able to extend the day if needed.
Well, Ms. Stilley, I have a question. I thought maybe Brett would cover it, but he didn't. Not that he knew what my question was anyway, but Melissa, explain to me a little bit more about, I don't think I'm understanding, in the fall when the kids come back, when you said blended virtual, does this mean that maybe they could stay at home and do the class as long as they're registered, so they can do it from home now, or they can go to school 2 days a week and then stay home 3 days a week? Is that what you're trying to say?
So a full virtual, of course, means it's fully online. And yeah, for some students that, for instance, have, they may have health issues or immune issues or other things, asthma, and parents maybe they're a little afraid for them to come back to the general population in August. We'll be equipped and ready to offer full virtual for those students. And then the, of course, blended model is where they could come to school some and then do virtual.
Wow.
And still be registered at that school. So, for instance, just an example, you know, you can have a student that attends, you know, Punchbowl Junior High that, you know, there's options for parents. And we talked about this on our Zoom conference today with principals. You know, the one-size-fits-all sort of cookie-cutter approach, We have to kind of think a little differently in terms of, you know, some parents may want full virtual for their students, but they're still a student at that school. They're still on the roll at Punchbowl Junior High. You know, they can still participate in the activities and clubs and all the things that they can do, but that's their option that they choose. Others may want to go with a more blended approach where they come on certain days or their scheduled times when they meet face-to-face with the teacher, but they do a lot virtually. And then others, you know, of course, the traditional, which is every day at school in bricks and mortar. So what we're trying to look at is how we can build out our platform so that there's options for families.
I think that's a great idea. Now, this will be taught by the classroom teacher as she's teaching the other 25 kids. How would that technology follow her around the room as she's teaching?
Well, not exactly. I mean, there would be, for the virtual classes, there are actually videos and instructional things that kids download. They can actually watch the teacher teaching a lesson that's pre-recorded.
Okay.
There's, you know, the practice, the guided practice, the independent practice, all that built into the online.
It would be the live lesson while she was teaching it or he was teaching it.
No.
Okay.
No. Right. But teachers could do Zoom calls with groups of students where, you know, they're going over material, doing additional guided practice with them.
I'm doing that now, and I just like to say, Ms. Zilly, it's working wonderfully. It's really doing well. Mm-hmm. I don't say thank you for that.
Sure, thank you.
Melissa, I would like to ask a question on this as well. So these students have to say what they want to do ahead of time. They do it from week to week. They want to go 3 days a week this week, but come full-time student in the building next week? Or do they, how do they do that?
Well, it would be a decision that is based at the school level. And for some students, the full online is a good model, but it's not for all kids. And so, I think those are decisions that have to be based. But yes, parents along with the school administration would make those decisions based on the needs of those children.
But would it be at the beginning of the school year? Could they switch mainstream, midstream to the school year? Could they switch and say, okay, I want to come back to school. I don't want to do the virtual anymore?
Yeah, so we talked about that today on our Zoom call with our principals. And the idea is let's just say Randy is a student, and his family, wants to do an online virtual, full virtual. But after about, 6 weeks, Randy's really not at the performance level that he needs to be at, and he's not doing so well. Then a conversation happens where Randy maybe needs to go to a more blended model, or maybe full every day at the school, So it's not like you wait till the end of the year, but, every 4 to 6 weeks you can assess that and find out if that's really working for that student. And if it's not, just like in anything else, you make that adjustment.
Okay, this is where I'm really trying to go with this. So you couldn't do this week by week. So if they...
No, no. Uh-uh.
Right, if they wanted to use you have 2 days this week, they can just...
No.
Okay, that's where I was going with that.
Okay. No, it's every 6 week or 9 week. We're on a 9 week grading period. So I would think that it would be a 9 week at least. And then, if it's not working, because sometimes, online sounds great. And then when you get in and you start doing it, you think, oh, this is like really hard, or this is really difficult or different. So, then we can switch them over where it's more of a blended or full bricks and mortar. And, our thought process on this is that, today in the times that we live in, there are all kinds of options and choices for parents, okay, and families, as there should be. There are full virtual schools out there where they're taking classes from strangers. There are other schools that open up that, do a blended model where, maybe they come in for a couple of days and they do blended again. Is that sometimes there's a fee or tuition with that. And what we're saying is, hey, we can do this in our school system, and it's no charge for the parents. It's free. And, we can offer different models for parents to choose for what works best for them. Some parents want their kids to come to school every single day. Some parents would like the idea of maybe their student doing virtual and coming into school maybe, 1 day or 2 days a week. Some parents love the idea of the total virtual. So, again, it's a family, I think, decision, and it's a decision that educators can really talk with parents about helping make that right decision.
Okay. I think, Mr. Jerry, you would raise your hand first, and then Janice will come to you. Another good way of getting my attention, because I can't see the hand sometimes, if you unmute your mic, that tells me that you're waiting to say something. So as long as you have your mic muted, then I'll try to do them in order, so we're fair. But Mr. Jerry, you're next.
Okay. Ms. Stilley, we talked about the possibility of the virtual
class, the virtual classroom being made available to students who have questions about math problems, or they have they want to ask a question about the history lesson that they don't understand and that mm-hmm. needs clarified. I know that these smart boards that we have in the classrooms are capable of that. Is that something that has come under consideration for a student who would be doing virtual studies at home?
I think it's a possibility. I do know it's possible. I think that, there would have to be, there's a couple things, that you have to consider. The obvious, the videoing of other students in the class, where the parent at home or the student, the parents or the student at home would see. But I think there's some things like that we have to work around. But also, I think once you would see a truly virtual class, with you actually see the video of a teacher teaching the class and teaching the skill and the guided practice, you would probably see that would be probably more effective. But I don't think that it's not possible to do that through the smart board and do like what Randy was saying, like a live feed. But I'm not sure it's the best way.
And I'm speaking strictly for a student who may not have chosen to do virtual classes, but is doing virtual school because they have to, because of some of the things that you spoke about earlier.
Yeah.
Physical impediments, or whose health is at risk, and it would be just an awesome way for them to feel included in the class. Mm-hmm. And I guess we would have to work around the issue of parents having issues with their children being filmed. But I hope that is something that we can include in this.
Thank you.
Ms. Janice?
Yes. Superintendent, I think that's a great idea, too. Do you think that it could possibly be incorporated with in our discipline plan, too? Like, say, if a child is suspended for 3 or 4 days, is it possible that we could do that and so that they would stay up with the schoolwork?
Absolutely. That's one of our concerns now, is if we have a student that's suspended out of school for 1 or 2 or 3 days, that they're missing that classwork. And so this would absolutely be a way to keep them where the class is in terms of their academics. So absolutely. And that's actually, Janice, in our strategic plan that we had, that we approved a couple years ago, was to find a way to provide that virtual connection when students are out of school.
Thank you.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Mr. Jerry. Do you have a follow up?
Yeah. I mean, that would be an awesome consideration for the alternative school as well.
Yes.
You know, especially because a lot of the kids who are there probably would benefit greatly from not feeling totally separated from their classrooms.
And they do some of that now. They already do some of that.
Yes.
That's excellent.
Ms. Stilley, I did have one question on the vacancies. I know we're at a skeleton crew at central office. Vacancies that are being filled, are we still working on that as far as filling the vacancies, preparing for August? Like assistant principals or principals or whatever, things that have been advertised.
Yes. Yes, some have just, I think, finished advertising, and we'll be scheduling out interviews virtually, by Zoom.
We may have lost Ms. Stilley for a second. I think we did lose Ms. Stilley for a second.
There, she's back.
Yep, she's back. Ms. Stilley, you're back?
Yes, I don't know. I just cut out here for a minute.
Yeah.
So, yes, we're proceeding with those vacancies, and we're going to be doing the interviews virtually.
Okay. All right. Any other questions to Ms. Stilley before we move on to the next item? Ms. Simmons, I see your hand. Go ahead and unmute your mic. Unmute your mic, Ms. Simmons. There you go. Now we have you.
Okay. All right, can you hear me?
We can. Go ahead.
I guess you already covered this, Stilley, at some point. I think you did online or something. So if a student's in fifth grade right now and they were having trouble, when they go back to school in the fall, do they go, they will know by the fall whether they go to fifth grade or sixth grade, right?
Yes, they will. Their report cards, Ms. Simmons, will be mailed to them before the end of school, just like they would any if we were physically in school, and they would know where they are. And then, of course, we're going to do that diagnostic assessment as soon as we get them in school to find out what their gaps are.
But if they're in fifth and they pass them to sixth, they're still going to take that test when they get back, right?
Yeah, every student will be given that diagnostic test.
Right, but the grades now will be evaluated by the scores that they had up until this point.
Yes, for K through 11th grade, we can only take in what they have made up to the point that they were
out of school.
Yeah. And then we will be offering summer school for students that are eligible that maybe, like, would have failed that grade or something. We're going to offer summer school as an option for those students as well.
Thank you.
All right. Mr. Jerry, you have yours unmuted. Would you like to ask another question?
Yeah, I would like to know, is that if we do schedule summer school, if that becomes available to us, will we offer that to some of the students who feel that they have fallen behind because of a lack of the electronic devices and who feel that they're going to need a little bit of a boost before the year starts?
If you're talking about the summer program, Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Yeah. So the summer program is really specifically for students that that meet certain criteria, like if they're failing the subject. So that's where the priority is for those particular students. So they, as far as I know right now, I don't think any student can just sign up to go for that. But I think that if there are students out there who we can work with our school principals on this, that maybe they have internet access but no devices, we can work with them on trying to, by the time we get more in, to get them something to work on at home in the summer.
Okay, good. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Seeing no other mics unmuted, Ms. Sandra, yours is still unmuted, but I'm assuming you already asked your question. That's correct. We'll move on.
Okay.
We'll move on to item B under superintendent's report for the recommendation of the outside charter school evaluator. Ms. Stilley?
Yes, we have Mr. Jinko on the call, and he's going to brief us on this particular item. Mr. Jinko?
Good evening, Ms. Stilley. Good evening, board members, and good evening to anybody in the public that is watching the meeting. On March 5th, Tangipahoa School System received an application for Kennedy Elementary Charter School. After that, we put out an advertisement for a third-party evaluator that was going to review the charter and will make a recommendation to the board. Our deadline has passed. We have two applicants that have submitted the paperwork. We've reviewed the two applicants. Our recommendation to the board is Ms. Kimberly Williams of Strategic Solutions. Ms. Williams has worked with us the past couple of years on some previous charter reviews that we've had. So Ms. Williams is our recommendation to the board as our third-party evaluator. They have until June 12th as the deadline. So after she does her interviews with the charter school individuals, with the school system, she will come to the board, make a recommendation, and this will happen before June 12th.
Okay. So do I hear that in the form of a motion to accept the recommendations of the administration?
Move to adopt the administration's recommendation.
Mr. Duncan's made the motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Roll call, I'm sorry, any discussion? Any questions of Mr. Jinko?
Okay. So, Mr. Jinko, you said this charter school recommendation is for what area?
Mr. Moore, that is, they really, will go into that with the evaluator. That third party, the individual that we recommended, will review all that. My understanding from what I've read is in the Hammond area.
Mr. Jenko, Mr. Kohler, can I be recognized?
Go ahead, Mr. Duncan. I'm sorry.
Because it probably would be a good idea to just review the process with everybody on how this charter application process is required to work according to statute. Can you just want to talk about what we have to do and what phase we're in?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Duncan. Obviously, we have received the application from Kennedy Elementary Charter. We have done the second part where we have advertised for our third-party evaluator. This next part is where the recommendation from the third-party evaluator will come tonight. After tonight, I will notify the third-party evaluator, whoever that individual is, hopefully Ms. Williams, will recognize and notify the Kennedy Elementary Charter Group that we have a third-party evaluator. That individual will contact the Kennedy Elementary Charter Group, review all their documentation, will set up interviews with the charter group and a group from the school system. Then we'll interview the school system individuals. The evaluator will review all the information and come to the board to make a recommendation whether the board accepts the charter application or reject the charter application. If the board rejects the charter application, it could move to Bessie for approval that way. If the board approves the charter recommendation, then we will work with the charter for them to begin their school system 2021.
And Mr. Deco, my understanding of the statute is that we do not have the option to not hire a third-party evaluator to handle the evaluation of this application, that we are required to bring somebody in from the outside to evaluate this application and bring their assessment to us. Is that right?
That is correct, Mr. Duncan, and I apologize for leaving that part out. You're correct.
Okay. Ms. Abrams, I see yours is unmuted.
Hi.
Okay. Ms. Janice, did you have a question?
No, mine.
What about, Mr. Jenko, what about cost?
Both individuals, both applicants had the same exact cost of $3,000 for their services.
Okay. We have a motion and a second on the floor. Any other discussion? Seeing no other discussion, call for roll call vote, please.
Ms. Simmons,
yes or no?
Yes.
Ms. Dominguez?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Mr. Toler?
Yes.
Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Bush?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Ms. Richards?
Yes.
Mr. Westmoreland?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Motion carries. Thank you very much. Item C, consider approval for Hunt Land Holding as the E-rate selection for managed services. Mr. Diaz, I believe this is going to be your...
Thank you, Mr. President. Yes, thank you, Mr. President. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
That time of year again, E-rate season. The only thing we went out for bid for this year was for a new managed services contract. What managed services are the maintenance for network switches, firewalls, et cetera, all the network hardware in place in the school district right now. We had three proposals put in. We chose Hunt Land Holding LLC as our recommendation. You may recognize that name. They were the only local company that actually submitted a bid. You may recognize the Hunt name from our cyber attack briefings when I would keep you up to date on what was happening there. That company is actually a company of Kevin Hunt's, who was a big portion, a big part of getting the district back up and going, works tirelessly with our team to get us back to where we needed to be. We feel really good about this recommendation. Pricing of the three was all basically very close. It's based on per cost per student per year. And as I said, this is an E-rate deal, so depending on the year, depending on free reduced lunch count, we actually pay anywhere from 10 to 14 cents on the dollar for this contract.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Diaz. Open it up to get a motion for put on the floor.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, Mr. Dominguez has made the motion to accept
I'll second.
Recommendations. We have a second from Ms. Sandra Simmons. Any discussion? I'm going to look for open mics if y'all have any discussions and questions. I would like to say that, you know, because of Hunt's work in the past, we have a parish-wide network of fiber that has been critical in our schools, and we see it today, especially with the technology that we need to move forward. So I do appreciate the work they've done. Any questions? Seeing no questions, I'll call for a roll call vote. Ms. Jenkins?
Ms. Simmons?
Yes.
Mr. Minkus?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Mr. Tolbert?
Yes.
Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Bush?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Ms. Richards?
Yes.
Mr. Westmoreland?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you very much. We did not have it on the agenda, but we did want to open up an opportunity for the board members to have board comments. So, just out of being fair, we'll do an alphabetical order. Ms. Abrams, you are up first.
Slow the day, I guess I am. I'd like to say how wonderful Ms. Stilley and the whole central office have been through this trying time. I know this is uncharted territories for all of us, and we want to keep everybody healthy, and y'all have made that obvious that that's what you want for our school system. I think y'all are doing a great job. Need to be commended for that, and for keeping the spirits up, especially when you had the COVID-19 yourself. So everybody just stay safe, and hope to be back into our boardroom soon.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Abrams. Mr. Bush?
Just be safe, everyone.
Okay. Ms. Dominguez? No comments. Mr. Duncan?
Nothing else for today. Thanks, y'all.
Mr. Moore?
Yes, I just wanted to say, Ms. Stilley, I'm glad that you're back and that you're healthy. And I'll keep you in my prayers that you continue to get stronger. You have answered some of the questions that I had that I didn't have to pose. You know, my major concerns has been, you know, what's going to happen to the kids who are behind. And I think that you're on top of that. For the rest of the board, I just want to say, you know, you guys stay healthy, and hopefully we'll be back in business soon.
Absolutely. Ms. Richards?
I just like to say that I'm glad to see that the superintendent has gotten her strength back. We're grateful for that. Also, would like to just do an update on our principal up at Kentwood High School, Mr. Bates, and his daughter, who are waiting it out right now. And I talked to him today, and he said that he was getting his strength back, but it's really, really a fight. And he's still weak. So we want to continue to pray for our parish and everyone that's going through this. And we're just asking, pleading, and begging everyone to please stay safe and stay home.
Thank you, Ms. Jess. Ms. Sandra Bailey Simmons.
Yeah, I've already said this at some point, I guess, when we did our time on the messages, but I am, again, so grateful and thankful that we have Ms. Stilley in the leadership position that she's in to get us through this hard time, and that God has healed her and her family and kept them well after she went through what she went through. But again, I am just so encouraged and impressed by what she, but and also her staff and Mrs. Jinko and the others that are right there with her, what they have been doing to keep things afloat, and I'm thankful.
Thank you, Ms. Senator. Mr. Westmoreland.
Yes, I'd just like to let everyone know that we are praying for them. I know we are going to get through this, and we're going to get through this uncharted territory, and we're going to come out very well with it. So thank y'all.
This too shall pass. Real quick, I want to give a shout-out to Mike, Ms. Dina, and Ms. Cindy Jenkins for their work with this technology, getting this to work. And it seems like every time I speak to a teacher or an administrator, they're either just coming out of a Zoom meeting or going into a Zoom meeting. So we all applaud the work that y'all are doing to keep everybody informed. Also, Mr. Bush had asked a question right before the meeting began. Would we be doing this in May? We don't know. We hope not. We hope we're in the boardroom, that we can see each other face-to-face and debate, discuss, and move forward with plans. But we have this option, and we'll use it if we have to, but obviously we want to be back in the boardroom. Also, a shout-out to teachers and parents for their patience and their participation in this. To see, you know, I'm married to a teacher and a parent, and to see her try to touch base with kids and to see them driving the streets, going to the house and dropping things off at the road, it just amazes, and I know that there's a lot of teachers that are doing that. Class of 2020, everything that can be done will be done to honor your accomplishments, to celebrate your graduation, and we are going to work, do everything we possibly can to make sure that we can celebrate you. The last thing I want to say is give us just uplift the Travis family. We had a bus driver that we lost in this area, Matt Travis, who was a bus driver for the Spring Creek and Sumner area. Larger than life bus driver that was just on the top of the world. He didn't die from COVID. He died from some infections that he had that he couldn't get rid of. But he was in his 40s and just one of our best employees. So I want to give a shout out to the Travis family that we're here for them and that we are praying for them and for their comfort.
Injuries can occur anytime, anyplace, and it may not be your fault. I'm Attorney Sherman Mack, and it's my duty to make sure you get the legal representation that you deserve. At the Mack Law Firm, we represent you and your family, and we'll make sure your legal needs are met. Contact us at tangilawteam.com. Our team is ready to help.